Recorded Books presents a Lone Star audio production, Tombstone, by Matt Braun. This unabridged recording is narrated by Peter Waldren. Recorded Books is the producer and publisher of Lone Star Audio, celebrating the work of great writers from Texas. And now, Tombstone.
Chapter 1. Starbuck angled across Larimer Street, one eye on the police station. The Colt 45 stuffed in the waistband of his trousers gave him an uncomfortable moment. He was accustomed to enforcing the law, and the city ordinance against carrying firearms struck him as damn fool nonsense. His suit jacket concealed the gun, but he was still irked that progress had put him on the wrong side of the law. Denver, like most western cities, considered itself a progressive metropolis. With 1881 drawing to a close, the population was approaching 100,000, and frontier customs were slowly losing ground to the civilized edicts of reformers. Not that old Denver had completely succumbed to the new cosmopolitan posture. Graft and bribes still assured the discreet operation of whorehouses, gaming parlors, and busthead saloons. Yet it was now a hub of commerce, with two railroads and an expansive financial district, and a law against carrying guns. Starbuck began wondering why he'd ever left Texas. As he moved past the police station, it occurred to him that hindsight was the worst of all vantage points. However enlightening, it made a man feel very much the dim dot. A brisk December wind whipped out of the northwest with biting force. He grunted, testing the wind for snow, and hurried along the street. Halfway down the block, he turned into the entrance of the Brown Palace Hotel. In the lobby, he pulled out his pocket watch and checked the time. The letter from Vernon Whitehead had indicated 10 sharp, and he still had a couple of minutes to spare. He inquired at the desk, and much as he expected, Whitehead's name commanded instant attention. The clerk pointed him in the right direction, all the while emphasizing that the gentleman in question occupied the hotel's finest suite. Starbuck crossed the lobby, gazing around at the ornate decor and a garish mural covering the breadth of the ceiling. He thought it beat the hell out of a bunkhouse. Mounting the sweeping staircase, he was reminded that the whole operation had been organized on a large scale. Early next spring, the presidents of every cattleman's association throughout the West would converge on Denver. Their purpose would be to unite in the formation of the International Cattlemen's Association. Their primary goal, aside from joining forces against homesteaders, would be an organized, far-reaching campaign directed at rustlers and horse thieves. Vernon Whitehead, chairman of the executive committee, had extended an invitation for him to attend a preliminary planning session. He was to be considered for the position of chief range detective. John Chisholm, perhaps the most respected of all Western cattlemen, had recommended him for the job. Some months earlier, he had been instrumental in disbanding a gang of rustlers who were preying on Chisholm's vast New Mexico spread. At the same time, he had had a hand in tracking down Billy the Kid and was present the night Pat Garrett killed the young outlaw. The attendant publicity had advanced his already formidable reputation as a manhunter. Upstairs, Starbuck proceeded along the hall and stopped before the door of the suite. He removed his hat, tugged the lapels of his jacket straight, and knocked. The murmur of voices inside quickly subsided, and a moment later the door opened. An older man with a shock of white hair like candy floss greeted him with an outstretched hand. "You must be Luke Starbuck." "Yes, sir, I am." "And you're Vern Whitehead." Whitehead stepped aside. "Come on in and meet the rest of the boys." The suite was lavishly appointed. A thick Persian carpet covered the sitting room floor, and grouped before the fireplace were several chairs and a plush divan. The other committee members, Sam Urschel, Oscar Belden, and Earl Poole rose and moved forward. After a round of introductions, Whitehead motioned everybody to chairs. There was no attempt at small talk. These men were ranchers with little polish despite their wealth, and today they were all business. From the outset, it was apparent that Whitehead would act as spokesman for the group. Moreover, it was equally clear the interview would proceed along the lines of an interrogation. Whitehead assessed him with a shrewd glance. "You as good as John Chisholm says you are?" Starbuck wasn't impressed. They obviously meant to put him on the defensive, and the tactic didn't sit well. He let him wait while he rolled a smoke. After flicking a match on his thumbnail, he took a long drag and exhaled. "No offense intended, but you shouldn't have sent that invite unless you'd already checked me out." "Oh, we checked you out, Mr. Starbuck. We can't afford to go on the say-so of nobody, not even John Chisholm." "Then I reckon you got all you need." "Well, let's see." Whitehead extracted a sheaf of papers from inside his jacket. He snapped them open and began reading. "Says here you've been a range detective since the summer of 76. Headquartered at Ben Langham's LX Ranch down the Texas Panhandle. Worked out of there for the Panhandle Cattlemen's Association." "Close enough." Starbuck admired the tip of his cigarette. "Except for the time I was out on loan to Chisholm. Says here you've killed 14 men. I never took time out to count." Whitehead fixed him with an inquiring gaze. "Does 14 include the ones you hung?" "Nope." Starbuck looked at him without expression. "That would make it considerable higher." "Not bad for a fellow." Whitehead consulted his notes. "Who's just pushing 34? How is it a man your age ain't never been married?" Starbuck smiled. "I like my work." "Do you now?" Whitehead tapped the papers with his finger. "According to this, you inherited the LX from Langham and sold out to a bunch down in the Panhandle. That must have left you sitting on Easy Street." "I got enough to see me along." "Hold on," Oscar Belden interrupted. "Hey, you got money to burn, and you're trying to tell us you aim to keep on working for wages? Some of us find that a mite hard to swallow." "I told you," Starbuck said in a deliberate voice. "I like my work. How much I've got in the bank doesn't concern you or anyone else. That's my business." The words were spoken with the iron sureness of a man who tolerated very little from others. Starbuck was a full 6 feet, but built along deceptive lines. He was lithe and corded, cat-like in his movements, with a square jaw and lively chestnut hair. 5 years as a range detective had brutalized him, and the vestiges of a violent trade were etched around his eyes. He had the steely gaze of someone who stayed alive by making quick estimates. And now, staring at the men, he wasn't at all certain he wanted the job. They seemed far too picky to suit his style. "Let's suppose," Whitehead resumed, "that we offered you the job. Could you recruit 10 or 12 good men and teach them to follow orders, no questions asked? I'm talking about a squad of detectives that would go wherever they're needed and do whatever they're told."
"It all depends."
"On what?"
"On who gives the orders," Starbuck said flatly. "I take assignments, but I don't take orders. Either I do it my own way, or I don't do it at all."
"Now, John Chisholm," Whitehead paused as though weighing his words, "told us you was strong-headed. We might be willing to give you the leeway needed if you was willing to hold yourself accountable to the executive committee."
"I take it you mean yourself and these other gents."
"Most likely," Whitehead acknowledged.
course, nothing's official till the association gets itself formed next spring, but that's the way it stacks up right now. Exactly what was it you had in mind that needs 10 or 12 men? Killing, Whitehead said bluntly. We wouldn't object if you brought in a few for trial, but we'd sooner see a thief hung than sent to prison. Sounds like you mean to form a death squad. Altogether, I reckon ranchers lose a couple of $1 million a year in rustled stock. We aim to put a stop to it, and I don't know no better way than the gallows tree. Starbuck unfolded slowly from the divan. There was a slight bulge over the six-gun in his waistband, and he adjusted his suit jacket. Then he looked from man to man, nodding last to Whitehead. I'll let you know. Before the cattleman quite realized his intent, he turned and walked to the door. The interview was concluded. On the way downstairs, Starbuck made a snap judgment. The job wasn't for him. There was no denying the honor involved. As chief range detective, his prestige among cattlemen would be greatly enhanced. Nor were there any qualms about the killing. The past 5 years had hardened him to the sight of death. Hanging a man wasn't pleasant, but neither was it repugnant. It was simply a function to be performed swiftly. An object lesson for those who robbed and murdered with godlike impunity. As for shooting a man who was trying to shoot him, there was no thought, no stirring of emotion, certainly no regret. He survived by allowing no man to threaten his life. So the job itself wasn't what bothered him. He was concerned instead about Vernon Whitehead. Some gut instinct told him the rancher had lied. He sensed that Whitehead would say anything, promise anything, to gull him into accepting the job. Further, he felt there was something of the tyrant about Whitehead. Though it hadn't surfaced during the interview, the telltale signs were there. The rancher, little by little, would begin issuing orders rather than assignments. Eventually, like a drill sergeant, he would demand blind obedience and unquestioning loyalty. All of which meant they would come to loggerheads. Somewhere down the line, Whitehead would show his true colors, and there would then be no choice but to sever the arrangement. It hardly seemed worth the effort or the aggravation. Then, too, there was no rush to accept the first job offered. As one of the committee members had pointed out, he wasn't exactly hurting for money. Upon the death of Ben Langham, an old friend and something of a surrogate father, he had inherited the largest cattle spread in the panhandle. Yet, even though Langham had thought to cure his wanderlust, the responsibility was ill-suited to his character. Some inner restlessness made it impossible for him to become tied down to people or things. He traveled light, and he traveled alone, obligated to no one but himself. Satisfied with his life and under no great compulsion to change, he had sold the ranch only last month. The proceeds, some $200,000, was stashed away in a bank in Fort Worth. The interest alone was enough to cover his immediate needs, with plenty to spare for an occasional whirl at the sporting life. And that afforded him the independence to do whatever he damn well pleased, especially where it concerned work. By the time he reached the lobby, Starbuck had decided he wanted no part of the International Cattlemen's Association. He wasn't sure where the decision would lead, nor was he overly concerned about the future. His reputation was established. And there was work anywhere in the West for a range detective who got results. Tomorrow was time enough to ponder his next move. For the moment, he had a definite yen to sample the nightlife of Denver. He'd heard there were parlor houses that specialized in Chinese girls. Young, slow-eyed Orientals whose plumbing was reportedly vice versa to that of white women. The mere thought galvanized him to a quicker pace. Approaching the hotel entrance, Starbuck noticed a man leaning against the wall. Heavy set and thick through the shoulders, he wore a bowler hat perched atop his head like a bird's nest. He smiled, flashing a gold tooth, and stepped into Starbuck's path. "Your name Starbuck?" "Who's asking?" "Mr. Griffin, Horace Griffin. He'd like to see you." Starbuck started around him. "I don't know any Horace Griffin." "He knows you." "Where from?" "Why not let him tell you himself? Mr. Griffin's division superintendent of Wells Fargo, and that's all I'm authorized to say." Starbuck stared at him a moment, then shrugged. "Well, what the hell? Won't cost me nothing to listen." The heavy-set man smiled, indicating the door. Outside, they turned onto Larimer Street and set off at a brisk walk across town. Some 10 minutes later, they entered the Wells Fargo and Company express station. There, Starbuck was ushered into a private office and greeted by a man who introduced himself as Horace Griffin. Solemn as a priest, Griffin wasted no time on amenities. He offered Starbuck a chair on the opposite side of the desk and came straight to the point. "Mr. Starbuck, I know all about your meeting with the Cattlemen's Association. If you've accepted the position, then I won't compromise you further. If not, then I have a proposition that may very well interest you."
"How'd you get wind of the meeting?"
"One of the members on the executive committee is a close personal friend, which one really has no bearing on our discussion." Starbuck eyed him, considering. "Suppose we just say I'm at loose ends." "Fair enough," Griffin agreed. "I presume you've heard of Tombstone?"
"Arizona?"
Griffin nodded. "In the past year, we've had 14 stages robbed in the Tombstone district. We carry express shipments and payroll boxes for the silver mines, so the losses have been substantial, very substantial."
"Sounds like you got yourself a problem."
"And getting worse." Griffin leaned forward, elbows on the desk. 10 days ago, our station agent in Tombstone disappeared."
How do you mean, disappeared?"
"Vanished, Mr. Starbuck. Without a trace."
Starbuck looked interested. "Any chance he was involved in the robberies?"
"More than a chance," Griffin replied. "Have you ever heard of Wyatt Earp, Doc Holliday?"
"Seems like I read something in the papers a while back. Near as I recall, it involved a shootout of some sort."
"The press dubbed it the OK Corral gunfight. Of course, that's neither here nor there. What does matter is that the Tombstone sheriff believes Earp and Holliday are behind the robberies. Unofficially, he also accused our agent, Marsh Williams, of being in league with them."
"And Williams suddenly disappeared?"
"Precisely."
"Has the sheriff brought charges?"
"Last year, shortly after one of the robberies, he arrested Holliday. All indications were that he had a good case. But the court dismissed the charges, even though there was strong circumstantial evidence. Coincidentally, Holliday's three alleged accomplices have since been killed in unrelated holdups."
"So where do you stand now?"
"Facing a stone wall," Griffin said dourly. "We transferred another agent into Tombstone, but he reports it's hopeless. Everyone is convinced Wyatt Earp killed Williams, and they're afraid to talk. We have no case, no evidence, and no way to stop the robberies."
"I get the feeling you're offering me a job."
"We know your work," Griffin ventured. "Please don't misunderstand me. I'm not referring to the men you've killed, but rather your investigative work. I was particularly impressed with the way you infiltrated that gang of horse thieves some years ago. Dutch Henry Horn, wasn't that the ringleader's name? For a fact, Starbuck noted. You've got a good memory.
I'm also an excellent judge of character, Mr. Starbuck. Quite frankly, we need an undercover operative in Tombstone. I believe you're the man for the job.
Starbuck examined the notion. I don't know beans from buckshot about stage robbers. What makes you think I could pull it off when your own people have failed?
Thieves are thieves, Griffin said equably. Their mentality differs little. Whether we're talking about horse thieves or stage robbers, you've demonstrated a knack for thinking the way they do and uncovering the evidence to expose them. In all candor, I believe you were made to order for Tombstone.
There was a moment of calculation. Then Starbuck fixed him with a stern look. I don't work cheap, and I'm plumb set in my ways. I do it at my own speed, and I don't follow nobody's rules, not even Wells Fargo.
Have no fear, Griffin assured him earnestly. I'll set no rules, and you can name your own compensation. Other than that, I have only two requests.
Oh? Starbuck's eyebrows rose in question. What sort of requests?
First, keep me informed through Fred Dodge, the station agent in Tombstone. Second, end the robberies by whatever means you deem expedient.
Unless I heard wrong, you're authorizing me to catch them or kill them, whichever works best.
I am indeed, Mr. Starbuck, and the quicker the better.
Mr. Griffin? Starbuck grinned and stuck out his hand. You just hired yourself a detective.
Horace Griffin heaved himself to his feet. He grasped Starbuck's hand in a firm grip and wished him luck in Tombstone. He thought it not only the best solution, but perhaps the only solution. Indeed, for Wells Fargo and Company, it made imminent good sense. Hire a killer to catch a killer.
Chapter 2. A week later, Starbuck crossed the line into Arizona territory. From there, he followed a southerly route, skirting the Dragoon Mountains through Sulphur Spring Valley. Then he turned southwest, bypassing Tombstone, and angled generally in the direction of Nogales and the old Mexico border. On a chill morning in late December, he rode into the headquarters of the San Bernardino Ranch. John Slaughter, who laid claim to all the land within a day's ride, operated the ranch somewhat like a feudal empire. He was a law unto himself along the border, and his JHS brand was burned on some 40,000 cattle and 5,000 horses. A former Texas Ranger, he had settled in Arizona when it was still the domain of the Apache tribes. An implacable man, he had fought the Apaches and Mexican banditos on their own terms and ultimately created a kingdom where no renegade dared enter. Of greater consequence to Starbuck, he was an old and trusted ally of a mutual friend, John Chisholm. The main house was an immense adobe, squatting somewhat like a fort around an open quadrangle. A veranda shaded by an overhead gallery spread across the width of the front wall. Starbuck dismounted, looping the reins of his roan gelding around a hitch rack, and slapped a cloud of dust off his mackinaw. As he walked toward the porch stairs, he noted that the window shutters, constructed of thick timber, were slitted with gun ports. He smiled, certain now that he'd judged the situation correctly. John Slaughter, not Tombstone, was the place to start. A mestizo servant met him at the door, taking his hat and mackinaw. Then he was led down a corridor, his spurs jangling on the tiled floor, and shown into a wolf's lair of a den. Saddles and range gear were strewn about the room, and the walls were lined by an impressive array of long guns. But the whole
was dominated by a battered walnut desk and the man who sat behind it. Starbuck was surprised. From the tales he'd heard, he had expected Slaughter to be a giant of a man, sledge-shouldered and stout as an oak. Instead, the man circling the desk was below medium height, on the sundown side of 30, with a slight paunch. Yet his whole bearing was charged with energy, and his face looked adzed from hard, dark wood. His eyes were gray and intense, and Starbuck was suddenly reminded that a man's size often counted for nothing. Determination and grit, when all else was tallied, were the measure of a man's worth. Slaughter halted, nodding amiably. "I'm John Slaughter." "Luke Starbuck." Starbuck extended his hand. "John Chisholm told me to look you up whenever I got over your way."
"Why, hell yes."
Slaughter pumped his arm with sudden enthusiasm.
"You're the range detective, the one that helped old John nail Billy Bonney and clean out Lincoln County."
"Former range detective," Starbuck told him. "I'm with Wells Fargo now."
"Well, I'll be jiggered." Slaughter indicated chairs in front of a blazing fireplace. "Take a load off your feet. Tell me all about it. You taking over the relay operation, are you?"
Starbuck saw no reason to hedge.
"Mr. Slaughter, I was hired as an undercover operative. They sent me down here to investigate Tombstone." "Call me John."
Slaughter lowered himself into a chair, suddenly somber.
"Luke, I'm sorry to say they didn't do you no favors with that assignment, not by a damn sight."
"Amen," Starbuck said without irony. "Matter of fact, that's why I've come to see you, instead of heading directly into Tombstone. I thought maybe you could give me the lowdown on things."
"What things?"
"Wyatt Earp, just for openers. Wells Fargo says him and Doc Holliday are behind all these stage holdups."
"Yeah, them and Bill Brosius."
"Brosius?"
"Curly Bill Brosius," Slaughter elaborated.
"He's leader of the gang that actually pulls the holdups. Part of his bunch are the ones Earp murdered at the OK Corral."
"Murdered?"
Starbuck was astounded. "I understood it was law business of some sort."
"Christ almighty, no. It was a falling out amongst thieves, plain and simple."
"How so?"
"Earp had the Wells Fargo agent in his pocket. He got all the dope on payroll shipments and fed it to Brosius through Doc Holliday. The gang robbed the stages and afterwards divvied up the take with Earp. Ain't nobody yet proved it, but you can bet your boots that is the way it worked."
"So what happened?"
"Well now, that's a tale and then some. Takes a bit of telling."
"Fire away," Starbuck grinned. "I've got nowhere to go." Slaughter hauled out a pipe and a tobacco pouch. After fussing around, he got it filled and puffing to suit him. Then he leaned back, the pipe jutting from his mouth like a burnt tusk, and began to talk. Wyatt Earp, along with his four brothers and Doc Holliday, had arrived in Tombstone the latter part of 1879. An ambitious man and quick to talk about his days as a lawman in the Kansas cow towns, Earp sought appointment as sheriff of Cochise County. Instead, the territorial governor appointed his chief rival, John Behan. Thoroughly disgruntled, Earp threw in with a group of gamblers and gunmen. At one time or another, their number included Luke Short, Bat Masterson, and Buckskin Frank Leslie. In the meantime, one of Wyatt's brothers, Virgil Earp, was twice defeated for the office of town marshal. Yet the second election produced the very ally the Earps needed. John Clum, editor of the weekly Epitaph, was elected mayor. Tombstone's other newspaper, The Nugget, was owned by Harry Woods, who supported Sheriff Behan. Earp and Clum, cast together as members of the opposing faction, soon became close friends, and the lines were drawn. Shortly thereafter, the stagecoach robberies began. Though no hard proof existed, word leaked out that Earp had formed an alliance with Curly Bill Brosius. Among others, the Brosius gang included the Clanton brothers, the McLowry brothers, and the most dangerous pistolero in Arizona territory, Johnny Ringo. Doc Holliday, on several occasions, was linked to the outlaw gang, but no solid evidence was uncovered, and therefore no connection to Earp could be established. The Earps gained a legal front, however, when the town marshal mysteriously departed Tombstone. Mayor Clum, now considered one of the family, appointed Virgil Earp to fill the post. Then, over a period of months, mutual distrust between the Earps and the Brosius gang ripened into open hostility. Only 2 months ago, on October 26th, it exploded in bloodshed. The Earp brothers and Doc Holliday cornered five of the gang at the OK Corral. Only two of the outlaws were armed, but that gave the Earps no pause. Within seconds, they killed three of the men. The others survived by dodging and running, all the while being fired on by Doc Holliday. In the aftermath, with the town council in a rebellious mood, Virgil Earp was stripped of his marshal's badge. Wyatt and Doc Holliday were formally charged with murder, and eyewitness testimony substantiated that the killings had been performed in cold blood. But just as Wells Spicer, a political crony of the Earp-Clum faction, chose to ignore the facts. In his decision, notable for its convoluted logic, he absolved Earp and Holliday of all blame. The charges were dismissed. After that, an eerie lull settled over Tombstone. The stage robberies abruptly ceased, and the Brosius gang hadn't appeared in town for more than a month. Earp and Holliday, conducting business as usual at the Alhambra Saloon, seemed to be biding their time. For what, no one had the faintest inkling. But everyone in Tombstone was convinced that Earp had yet another card up his sleeve. Despite his unsavory reputation, he was not noted as a quitter. "That's the gist of it," Slaughter concluded, knocking the dottle from his pipe. "Earp and his crowd lost a little ground, but they ain't done yet, not unless I miss my guess." Starbuck digested what he'd heard, silent a moment. Then he looked up. "What about Fred Dodge, the new Wells Fargo agent? Any chance Earp might try to work the same deal with him?" "I'd tend to doubt it. After what happened to Marsh Williams, he's the one that just up and disappeared. I suspect Dodge wouldn't much cotton to the notion of playing footsie with Earp." "What are the odds on Earp making his peace with Brosius?" "Well," Slaughter said speculatively, "I reckon anything's possible amongst cutthroats like them. But I'd say the odds are lots better that they're sitting around figuring ways to bushwhack one another."
"What makes you think so?"
"'Cause Brosius had a score to settle, what with Earp having killed three of his men. And Earp knows he ain't never gonna be safe till he's rid of Brosius, if for no other reason. I'd imagine he's damn tetchy about the fact that Brosius could tie him to those robberies."
There was a prolonged silence. Starbuck's gaze drifted to the fire, and he appeared lost in thought. At last, watching him closely, Slaughter shifted around in his chair.
"Where'd he aim to start?"
Starbuck kneaded the back of his head. "Way it looks to me, I've got to get in thick with Earp. He's covered his tracks on the outside, so I'll have to worm my way on the inside. Sooner or later, he'll slip, and when he does, I'll be there to get the goods on him."
"Sounds reasonable," Slaughter nodded gravely. "Of course, I don't have to tell you, you'll be walking into a den of vipers. One miscue, and they'll kill you deader than hell." I'll play it close to the vest. That's the ticket. Slaughter beamed. And by Jesus, if you need any help, all you gotta do is shout. I'd jump at the chance to tangle with them sorry bastards.
Now that you mention it, I could use some advice.
Anything at all, you name it. I need somebody to act as a go-between with Fred Dodge. Wouldn't do for me to be seen in his company, but I've got to funnel information through him to Wells Fargo. Does anybody come to mind?
Harry Woods, Slaughter informed him. That's your man.
The newspaper editor? Starbuck looked skeptical. I need somebody with a permanent case of lockjaw. You think he fits the bill?
God almighty bingo, Slaughter roared. Harry hates Wyatt Earp worse than the devil hates holy water. You couldn't find nobody better if you searched from now till doomsday.
Starbuck smiled, rising. I'll take your word for it, and I'm obliged. Slaughter argued persuasively, urging him to spend the night. But Starbuck had ridden almost 1,000 miles, and he was anxious now to begin the hunt. As the sun neared its midday zenith, he stepped into the saddle and rode north towards Tombstone. In early 1878, a bedraggled, footsore prospector struggled along the jagged mountain slopes east of San Pedro Valley. His name was Ed Shifflin, and quite literally, he stumbled upon one of the richest silver strikes in frontier history. With ore assaying at $20,000 a ton, the discovery sparked the greatest mining boom ever recorded in the Southwest. Shifflin named his strike Tombstone, and within a matter of months, the mile-high camp had mushroomed into a carnival of speculation. A stagecoach line was established across the 70-mile stretch of desert to Tucson. Men and machinery began pouring in, followed closely by merchants and tradesmen, gamblers and saloon keepers, and the finest assemblage of whores ever gathered in the Arizona barrens. From a few hundred whiskery desert rats huddled in tents and squalid shacks, Tombstone burst upon the map as a rip-roaring boomtown. Within 3 years, the population leaped to 6,000 and still growing. A town, complete with all the civilized vices, was spawned in a land previously thought inhabitable only by Apaches and scorpions. It was a dusty El Dorado, vitalized by the motherlode, and it ran wide open day and night. Starbuck left his horse at the livery stable early next evening. Dusk was settling over Tombstone, and he had no trouble losing himself in the crowds of miners thronging the streets. While it was approaching supper time, saloons and gaming parlors were already doing a brisk business. Within a half an hour, he had located the Nugget office. Outside a saloon, directly across the street, he positioned himself where he could keep a watch on it. His grimy trail clothes and bearded stubble made him all but invisible among the grubby miners. On his fourth cigarette, the wait ended. A man he assessed as the printer stepped out of the front door and hurried down the street. Only moments later, another man pulled the shades on the office windows. Grinding his cigarette underfoot, he crossed the street and entered an alleyway beside the newspaper. He located the back door and rapped softly. From inside, he heard the sound of footsteps. Then the door opened in a spill of light. The man who had pulled the window shade stood framed in the doorway.
Harry Woods?
Yes?
I have a message from John Slaughter.
Slaughter?
Woods appeared confused, then quickly stepped aside.
Come in, Mr.
Starbuck entered, waiting until Woods shut the door. The name's Starbuck, Luke Starbuck.
Are you one of Slaughter's men?
Not exactly. Starbuck inspected the shop, satisfying himself they were alone. I need some help, and Slaughter said you could be trusted. Woods was a gnome of a man,
with hair receding into a widow's peak and inquisitive eyes magnified behind thick glasses.
He was slender and quick, highly intelligent, and grasped immediately the secretive nature of his visitor. He indicated the front office. Come this way. Starbuck had reconciled himself to the risks involved in revealing his identity. Seated in the office, with Woods attentive and openly curious, he wasted no time in sparring around. He briefly described his mission for Wells Fargo, stressing the fact that he would be operating undercover. Then he related everything Slaughter had told him regarding Wyatt Earp and Tombstone's volatile political climate. He concluded by asking the editor to act as a go-between with Fred Dodge. Woods, visibly caught up in the intrigue, agreed without hesitation. One other thing, Starbuck added. I'll be operating under the name of Jack Johnson. Unless it's an emergency, don't even think of contacting me. One way or another, I'll manage to stay in touch with you. Anything else? Woods asked. Anything at all. I'm willing to go the limit if it'll rid Tombstone of Earp and his crowd. What about Earp? Starbuck responded. You got anything personal on him? Habits, family, that sort of thing? I do indeed, Woods laughed. I wrote an editor friend in Kansas and asked him to check out the newspaper files. What he turned up was enlightening, to say the least. Such as? Oh, the fact that the Earps got their start operating a two-bit whorehouse. Court records in Wichita prove it beyond a doubt. I'll be damned. Moreover, Wyatt and two of his brothers married some of their former whores. That, too, is substantiated by court records. Starbuck appeared puzzled. I always understood Earp was a lawman in Kansas. How does that square with what you say? He was an ordinary policeman, Woods countered. He brags about being city marshal, but that's pure Tommy rot. As a matter of fact, he was fired from the Wichita police force and all but run out of town. His record in Dodge City was somewhat better, but not much. He's a four-flusher and a liar, all puff and no substance. Starbuck decided to reserve judgment. Earp apparently resorted to violence and gunplay when necessary, and that hardly indicated a man without substance. What about his family? You mentioned wives a minute ago. Sluts! Woods invested the word with scorn. Common trash, and no better than the men they married. He paused, thoughtful. Earp's sister-in-law might be the one exception. Her name is Alice Blaylock, and from what I've seen, she's a cut above the rest. She's not married? Woods shook his head. She lives with Earp and his wife. All the brothers have houses nearby over at the west end of Fremont Street. Starbuck pondered a moment. Slaughter said Earp operates a faro game at the Alhambra. Is that it? No other business interests? I've heard rumors that he's involved with some of the big mining muckamucks. Of course, considering he's such a grifter, he might have started the rumor himself. Could you nose around and see what you can turn up? Glad to. Woods hesitated, studying him closely. If you don't mind my asking, how do you intend to approach Earp? Starbuck smiled. I'm a pretty fair gambler myself. Figured I'd meet him on common ground and see where it leads. Several minutes elapsed while they discussed Tombstone's sporting crowd.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.